So we can start. Once again, thank you all for joining us for this peer exchange and discussion on public service delivery in Africa and the Middle East. Really appreciate you taking the time to be part of this important discussion. This discussion is part of a series of peer exchanges and discussions that the Open Government Partnership Africa and the Middle East team is organizing around various topics that we think are important for the region. And these topics are topics that, you know, we have seen in the national action plans. Some of them we've discussed with civil society as well as governments on areas where they would want to learn more about, learn among stakeholders, but also to learn from other countries and other regions in how these commitments and implementation of these reforms are actually being implemented. So the idea for today is to really learn among ourselves on how to co-create and how to implement service delivery commitments and reforms. We will hear in the first panel from the experts and practitioners that are working in this space, implementing service delivery commitments, implementing service delivery reforms on how some of the challenges that they face and how they've actually implemented these reforms and how these reforms have actually transformed people's lives. Because at the end of the day, open government reforms are all about transforming people's lives. And I think now more than ever, service delivery is a very important issue within the region, but globally, as the world struggles to deal with COVID-19, and where I am in South Africa at the moment, we are back to lockdown because of the rising numbers of COVID-19 cases. And it's really affecting people's lives and people's livelihoods. And the effective and efficient implementation of service delivery has never been more important. And we hope that at the end of this discussion, we're able to have a sense of, to learn from others how they've effectively implemented these service delivery commitments and reforms, and they've actually transformed people's lives. So this is going to be a 2-hour discussion that I hope we'll all be able to learn something from it. Just also to remind everyone that please, there is interpretation, French, English, and Arabic. Please select the language that you'd want to hear from. Just go at the bottom of the Zoom page and go where there's interpretation, select the language that you'd want. So the first hour of our session will be facilitated by Aiden Yakuze, who is the executive director for TOWEZA, and is also our incoming civil society chair. So he will be facilitating the first part of the meeting. And then after the first panel is done, we will then move to breakout sessions on education, health, and water and sanitation. And you had all selected the panel that you'd want to join. So when we are moving to the breakout sessions, some of you will have to drop off and join a separate Zoom link so that you are able to still get interpretation in those Zoom links. So, further instructions will come at the end of this panel. So thank you very much. I would like to hand over to Aiden to take us forward.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Theo. And thank you all very much for joining. It's real pleasure to see all of you interested in this public service delivery peer exchange workshop. As Theo mentioned, public service delivery really is at the core, at the heart of the contract between citizens and the government that they put in to serve them. Citizens are affected by many different government policies, but it is to be expected that those which directly affect their lives every day are the ones that matter the most. Access to health, education for children, clean and reliable water services, all kinds of infrastructure that exists to make their lives and livelihoods work best. So the thing is, however, citizen dissatisfaction with the availability and the quality and the affordability of public services can also cause problems for society and for governments. It has fueled protests in some of our African countries, such as Nigeria, South Africa, and other places. So our argument as members of the OGP is that an open government approach to to public service delivery, open government approach, which is transparency, participation of citizens, and the ability of citizens to hold government to account, are really very good, central to making the public service delivery commitments really work and deliver for ordinary citizens. We've seen this through about a decade of OGP action plans implemented globally. In Africa and the Middle East, our data shows that 12 OGP countries have made 78 commitments related to public services since 2011. So that's on average 8 commitments, about 7 commitments a year. But here are some 2 important caveats I want to put. First of all, and this is a very subtle one, a number of these commitments are not really about public service delivery directly. They're sort of tangential to public service delivery than central to the commitment. For example, open data commitments are more about opening up education-related data rather than actually improving the delivery of improved education services. This is good, but more can be done. A second caveat, and this one's a bit more concrete and really challenging, and I'd like to posit that this is something we need to talk about in this group. Our ambitions, commitments on the continent suffer from poor implementation and lower completion rates on average than other commitments from our other counterparts in other parts of the world. So Africa, we have great and greatly ambitious commitments, but poor implementation, lower completion rates. How can we improve this? One of the things that is very interesting about the OGP is this new initiative, new-ish, of OGP local. And local government members of the OGP are showing particular promise and potential. I suppose, after all, it's local government which really bears the brunt of delivering public services. So we can see some examples here. In Sekondi Takoradi in Ghana, the metropolitan government is actually building a strong partnership with landlords and resident associations to increase the provision of a very basic service, household toilets, and minimize open defecation and to protect the health and safety of citizens. In Buenos Aires, in Argentina, they have created a comprehensive public database containing information on the availability of sexual and reproductive health services and a geolocation map of the centers to increase access to these services, especially by young people, by reducing the search costs and facilitating access. In Austin, Texas, a third example of an OGP local, they have created a way for citizens to have a larger voice in the services that affect them. And this gives the city service departments important, new, fresh, up-to-date information to inform their policy and budget decisions. So some things to think about as we have a chat. First of all, citizens want more, better, affordable public service delivery commitments that improve their lives. Second, these commitments really must be completed, implemented to completion, rather than being made promises that are left uncompleted. And third, and this is part of the magic of the OGP, partnership with civil society really does improve the design, the implementation, and the completion of public service commitments. It's both an assertion, but I think it is also a reality that is being demonstrated increasingly over time. So we're here today to share these experiences, and I really would invite us to be candid and open about the challenges, the opportunities, the triumphs that we're achieving in making the citizens, our own lives better through public service delivery. And so we have a great panel. I'll introduce them briefly, and then we'll go to a video, and then we shall come straight back to the panel. So we've got a panel from 4 different countries, or 3 countries, 4 organizations. One is Philip Thigo, Wave Philip, who is a technical advisor, innovation, data and innovation at the government of Kenya, and he's the OGP point of contact for the government of Kenya. Welcome, Philip. We have Zukiswa Kota, who is the head of monitoring and advocacy, a public service accountability monitor. Hello, Zukiswa, in your nice yellow scarf. We have Mohamed Usman. There you are. Mohamed Usman is from Nigeria. He is from the Kaduna State, and he's the government point of contact for Kaduna State, which is a member of OGP Local. Hello, Mohamed, nice to see you. And then we have Evelyn Changet, who is Chief Governance Officer, African Development Bank, and she is in Pretoria. That's why 3 countries, 4 different panelists, 2 of them are in South Africa. So welcome to you. And before we come into the questions, I'm going to invite Adna to play the video of an example of public service delivery in Mongolia in education. Adna.
Шин тайлан авчирч гүсэн эвдэрхийн ширээ сандалнуудыг шинжилж өгсөн. Орны гуцнууд нарийнхан орон дээр хөрвүүлсэн тэрийг өргөсгөж ойж өгсөн. Орны уртлын юм хөшөг ойж өгсөн. Шкафнууд янзлж өгсөн. Даа ер нь гэр орчин мөрдсөн болохоор хичээл их хөрөм зэрэгтэй тэгээд гэр нь гэрлэг юмар санагдах нь ховор болсон
шүү. Тэгэхээр зэрэг өмнө нь бол сургууль, энэ сумын өдрөдлөх
маш их өөрчлөлт. Өгнөө. Яг тэгвэл төсөл хэрэгжихээс өмнө аягүй том хүнд нөхцөлд амьдарч байсан, тогтохгүй орчинд амьдарч байсан өөрчлөлт чадсан. Ер нь бол одоо манай тогтолцоо бол дараа нар дээрээсээ иргэдэг чиглүүлдэг байсан бол одоо иргэгээд иргэдэн дараа нартаа өөрснийхөө ирэлт хэрэгцээнд нийцүүлсэн үйлчлэгийг авах хүслээ. Санаачлагаа өөрснөө чөлөөтэй гаргадаг юм болсон. А гэрэгдийнхээ нэг өөрсдийнх нь ингээд санаачлагад тулгуурсан үйлд ажиллагаа явуулахаар айгүй тийм бүтэмжтэй, айгүй өөр өндөр үр дүнтэй.
А сумын өдрлгүүдтэй бол сургуульд банкардын хандуулж өгсөн юм сайн төсөл болсон.
Арын нутгийнхаа өдрлгүүд энэ талаар миний бодол өөрчлөгдсөн. Би айгүй тус хүмүүс байна. Тасалцаа хэрэгтэй үедээ тэр хүмүүс танд яах ёстой юм гэдгийг ойлгосон.
Тэгэхээр зэрэг энэ жилийн бодлогоо зэрэг манай хүүхдүүд доктор байрны хүүхдүүд юм сургалт сургалгын дүн нь бол өнгөрсөн жилийнхээс бол нэлээд өндөр нагцтай болгосон байгаа. Ерөнхийдөө юм бол амжилт чанар нь бол сайжирсан гэж болж байна. За ер нь цаашдаа бол төслөө бол цэцэрлэгийн үйл ажиллагаа бол үйл ажиллагааг бол сайжруулах чиглэлээр бол төслөө хэрэгжүүлэх нь зүйтэй байна гэдэг дээр бол сумын удирдлагууд бол санал төгтэй болсон ажиллаж байгаа маа.
Тэр болгонд манайхаа ингээм хамтдаа хийе гэдэг одоо санаачлаад үргэлж одоо санаачлагыг гартаа аваад бүх ажлыг одоо.
Thank you so much, Adna, and the team that put that video together. And it was really fascinating to actually hear the language, Mongolian. I bet you many of you have never heard Mongolian before. That was your opportunity. But I think more importantly was the comment that was made by that lady, the government official, who said before the government didn't care about public opinion, we just told them what to do. But look at the results that are much better off. 80,000 Mongolians with much better access to better quality education and dorm rooms that look, you know, comfortable because they had this dialogue between government and ordinary citizens, probably mediated by a civil society organization. So let's dive right into a conversation about exactly that. And we'll start by inviting Philip from Kenya. Quick question for you, and you should answer my question, Philip. In your experience, how is transparency and data reducing opportunities for corruption and leading to the improvement of public service delivery in Kenya, specifically in Africa more generally? Where have you seen it work, Philip? Give us some hope.
Hope is scarce these days. Thank you so much, Aidan, and really a good example from Mongolia in terms of how to make things efficient. So I think a couple of things, and of course this is OGP, so we're always very honest, is to the extent that, see, data in itself is just an artifact. And what we've realized is that what we think is fundamental around the data is to the extent that the data can be wielded as information for citizens to engage from an evidence-based perspective on public service delivery. Because they do not necessarily, in some cases we've realized citizens do not even know what services government is supposed to offer in specific instances, whether education, health, or water. And so for me, data, to the extent that it's meaningful in a way that provides information, not volunteer data that must be meaningful for public service delivery. So that's an African experience. We are quick to open data, but in most cases not useful for public service delivery and citizen engagement. So we need to bridge those two. The second piece, of course, is what constitutes an informed citizenry. It's those components of engagement, because information in itself without context doesn't make sense. So how do you create those opportunities for engagement for citizens so that that data is contextualized, and so that they actually even know where the power lies? Because sometimes it's how do you shift the power from the duty holders to the duty bearers?
So let me just ask, if I could just jump in there. You made a really important point about data that is contextualized. We often hear from governments that we have set aside budget with very large figures, which are very hard for us to understand. How do you help contextualize budget figures in a manner that citizens then understand? Help us bridge that gap in your experience.
So in our case, there's this process of performance contracts. And many times I have a conversation with my civil society colleagues. I say, listen, the budget statement is nice, but you see, the performance contract is very specific. It's very granular, speaks about that project, right? It's just not a road, you know. A road is fine, but a road can be anywhere. You need to name that road, James Gishuru Road, an X amount of money, and this is how much it needs to be spent on that money. Governments need to go that granular, because a citizen only understands their specific context. And because a performance contract is signed by a government official, my sense is that that is a piece that needs to be open. And that is something that we are pushing on this particular aspect, because a contract contextualizes the budget figure. Than just having a budget figure on schools, decapitation grant, $2 million. It doesn't really make sense. Anyway, so that's basically how we see it can be done. The second piece, of course, is also strengthening that ecosystem so that even when a citizen understands that X amount of money needs to come to their road, there's oversight, including government's own oversight. So in our case, we have the access to justice, access to information, the Ombudsman Commission. And this is why they are co-chairs of our OGP permanent networking mechanism, because they're also responsible for maladministration. It becomes interesting so what happens when a government's department, minister of agency does not conform or deliver a service? You need to find a response mechanism that is within government. When that fails, then you bring civil society pressure to the extent that then how do you ensure that then that service is delivered? And one example we had was quite interesting quickly, I know I'm taking a lot of time, is we had a school that did not have water for 8 years. It's in Nairobi, so this is the most interesting base. And the response from donors was to build, because in a school, when school doesn't have water, your issue is the toilets, right? Because kids need to go to the toilets. So donors kept on building more toilets. Okay. And not necessarily solving this issue of no water, because then water could always be brought by a truck and people could drink, but what about the lavatories and latrines? But then what we realized was simple, is that at the fence, there was a community, somebody there who had diverted the pipe that should bring water into the school. So what then the school committee simply was reporting to the wrong person. So this is the most interesting thing. Kept on reporting to the wrong person. And without the dialogue with the community, they will not have known that there's somebody. Yeah, so it's not a systemic failure. It's just some character there at the fence who's cutting the water and has paid up very well into the council so that he's not held to account, also because he was selling the water. So this is the other interesting bit. So the idea was then the dialogue mechanism simply brought this community and the school together. They identified the chink in the chain of where the problem was, and water started flowing into the school after 8 years.
Okay. So context and a mechanism for them to actually engage with that transparent data.
A punitive mechanism. Somebody must be held to account.
Performance contract piece. Quick question, one word answer. Are your public your performance contracts public yet?
Yes, but not on our website. So this is what we are pushing with the Kenya Lands of Resident Association. This is where technology comes in. So we're trying to do that.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Philip, for great answers. Zukiswa, let's go down south to Zukiswa, Head of Monitoring and Advocacy at Public Service Accountability Monitor. So Zukiswa, PSAM has been active in advocating for open budgets, social accountability in South Africa's public service delivery. Can you share how specifically these approaches have helped improve accountability and citizen engagement and their inclusion in public service delivery, and how this is actually influencing the government's own open government interventions? Zukiswa.
Great, thanks Aidan. Yeah, that's a big question, and I think an important one that I'll try and answer as comprehensively as I can. I think first off, much like both Philip and the Mongolia video showed, is that many societal and service delivery issues are quite complex sometimes, but also that they're interrelated, and often it's that interrelation between civil, political, and socioeconomic rights. But also I think that, what we've seen is that many are exacerbated by policy, by poor policy formulation and implementation, very much as you were saying, Aidan, as well as the abuse of public resources, or even at a very basic level, mismatches between what formal government documents say and the informal spaces where decisions are made, which is again what the Mongolia video shows us. And so it's often been important to try to understand the dialogue or lack thereof between technocrats and politicians, as well as between technocrats, politicians, and ordinary members of the public, where policies that inform delivery of public services are concerned. So really what we've learned, in our work over the past 20 years and more, and many others, I think, in the space can share these reflections, is that in order to achieve the kind of sustainable impact in addressing these issues, there is a need to have, an eye on the broader institutional and systemic changes. So this is why for us, the kind of social accountability and open government interventions have continued to find centrality in our work. In recent years, we've focused on quite a bit on open data and fiscal transparency interventions that are intended to support governance improvements. And this has included civic tech projects, such as, the country's first national and provincial open budget data portal in partnership with the National Treasury. So that aspect of co-creation, with the lens that any open data or civic tech interventions have to, at their center, have people and improvements in governance or service delivery or well-being. So this, the development of the budget portal in particular, was necessitated by the recognition that despite high levels of fiscal transparency in South Africa, there were, persistent weak levels of public participation in the budget process, as well as weak levels of budget literacy and accountability. And you can imagine to some extent where we think the link between that and the delivery of services lies. Yeah. So I'd like to share two special and quite quickly two examples of how approaches to opening up government and entrenching public participation can or have had an impact on the delivery of services. Excuse me. So I was privileged at some point to be part of the advisory group for a project called the Accounting for Basic Services Project. which was a collaboration between different organizations in different provinces. And really the project was implemented across three different provinces of South Africa. And its core objectives were to ensure that marginalized communities, so people living in informal settlements in townships and rural areas, would be empowered with engaging their local municipalities or local government for the use of services or use of state resources, as well as the provisioning of basic services within their localities. So this is done in a number of ways, and I'm happy to speak to the details when in questions if we have time. But core to the project or core to the intervention was really that, ensuring that there was a deliberate process of opening up municipal budgets, but also creating the technical support and know-how for people to be able to access budget documents and planning documents in ways that are meaningful. Mm-hmm. So in 2017, there was the first rural social audit that was conducted, by the community of Glenmore, and after a while, empowered with both the municipal budgeting and planning information, as well as the results of the social audit, the community were able to place pressure on the municipality, who were ultimately place pressure for the delivery of particular services on a contract with that was outsourced. But ultimately, what resulted from that was through engagements, the municipality was then able to reopen a call for refurbishment of a sports field that had at the center of it an important function as a community hub and a youth space, and had until then been languishing and kind of a waste of resources. The second example, through engagements between a community of Chris Heine Park and the Buffalo City Municipality, surfaced a number of issues that were impacting service delivery. One of these was irregular billing for water by the municipality. And engagements over the budget and service delivery issues saw changes, and one of which was the reinstitution or resumption of a water reticulation process in Chris Heine Park, which then, addressed issues of erratic water billing, addressed issues of water access and availability, and addressed issues of water leakage. We live in an area with severe droughts. So really, just in conclusion, I think some of the lessons that emanated from those interventions are, on the one hand, issues of service delivery are really quite complex, but that introducing, the aspects of opening up budgets, opening up, the decision-making processes, but also the co-creation and discussion and engagement, building trust between civic actors, between citizens and municipal actors is really important. So for us, ultimately, we've seen this play out, or these decisions in terms of how it's informed the actions of civic actors in the OGP. So the first OGP local initiative in South Africa in the municipality has been influenced by some of these discussions and some of these events in terms of opening up budgets and the impact on delivery of services. And secondly, in the broader context, I think what's, quite clear to see as well is that there is a hopefulness emerging from these examples, which really is about what are the long-term paradigm shifts that are possible institutionally through open government initiatives. So I hope that those are two examples that maybe shed a bit of light on some of the complex issues, but where the hope lies.
Fantastic. Thank you, Zuki. So I mean, a sports field, better water provision, regular billing, these are very concrete public service delivery examples. But I like the way you sort of wrapped them in the important processes that do transparency and that build citizens' trust with the government processes. So in your area, there's this beautiful song I like, which says, Asina Mali, so government can't claim that they don't have money, right? They do, they just, once citizens have seen it, they know how to deploy it. Thank you very much. Let me turn to, now we're going to up to West Africa, to Mohamed Usman. Mohamed, you are with the Eyes and Ears Initiative in Kaduna State, which is an OGP local member. Can you tell us how has that initiative improved public service delivery in Kaduna? And how did you really embed systems of accountability and feedback and better citizen participation in public service delivery in Kaduna? Mohamed, welcome.
Thank you. So let me give a bit of context. Kaduna State is one of the 36 states in Nigeria, located in northern Nigeria, with about 9 million people. as at 2020. So when this government came in 2015, the state of the education of the state, yes, was very terrible. The governor had to declare a state of emergency on education, awarded contracts to renovate over 75% of the schools in the state. 1 year after that contract, with all the millions of dollars spent in fixing those schools, the result was a disaster, simply because it was an engagement between the government and the contractors. Contractors were brought in, gave contracts to renovate schools, and some contractors absconded, collected money and disappeared. Some contractors did well, while some did a terrible job. So it was a mix of different wide spectrum of performances. So then the government had to sit and decide, okay, what was wrong? And then eventually there was poor monitoring and evaluation of the project cycle from beginning, from even the contract award to the completion stage. So that brought in different layers of checks and balances to ensure that projects going forward do not suffer similar experiences. So that's one of the reasons, that's the main reason that brought about the eyes and ears system, which has two different components. One, a component of check from the government, and then a component of check from citizens themselves. The government felt that the citizens themselves have a right to decide whether the project going on in their community is going well or not. Mm-hmm. So in that case, we have a check, some monitoring layer from the ministry that awarded the contract, then the procurement agency, but then the government felt like you need an input, or you need opinion of a layman, like just walking by, seeing the project, seeing the construction. What will you think? Is it working well? Is it not working well? And then the people of the community themselves, like they should tell you whether that project they are seeing, you don't have to be technical experts in construction or anything, but like by mere seeing, they should be able to ascertain whether it's good or not. So essentially that's how it started. So it has two components, one from the government, the M&E department, which are economics experts, they are business administrators, so they have no background in construction. They go to the field, then with geolocation coordinate with pictures, and then report on those projects. And then the communities too, they see the project in their communities, and then they snap pictures, they send in with their reports too. So this was some sort of layer of checks and balance that seriously improved the performance of those contracts going forward. Like the result after or post that system is very impressive. We also have a system within the same platform that rank contractors from the excellent and the worst. And then we have a system that blacklists contractors based on your previous performances. You'll be blacklisted that you'll never be awarded a contract in the state.
So, let me interrupt you. When you say that the outcomes were very impressive, give us an example of an impressive outcome.
Okay, so let me give you an example. Like since the system started working, we've registered about 8,619 projects on the system. And out of those 8,000 projects that were registered in the system, we can, even though not all have been completed, of that 8,000, about 5,620 have been completed. And out of that 5,000, 4,600 have been completed without any problem, without any, as into the highest level of performance that the contractors were paid their retention and there's not any problem. So if you compare it to what it was before, when over 90% of the entire project was a disaster, that was what even necessitated the creation of the procurement department and all that. So that was what informed my choice of it was impressive, because the numbers really showed that there was improvement in the public service delivery. And then with even the citizens, out of those projects, the citizens reported about 1,820 projects, which about among that 1,200 projects were as in either reviewed, or the contractor was queried to go and fix whatever they are complaining about, which shows that their input were taken into, and it goes to the level to show that they are having trust in government to actually take their complaints and do what they are complaining about. Even though some of those complaints, that's why just 120 were resolved, some of those complaints, probably they did not understand, or the government did not release funds to the contractor to continue the work, and so much and so forth.
And most of these were in schools, were they? These were mostly the 5,000 or 8,000 projects. Are they schools, or is it more like water, maybe roads? What kind of service delivery are we talking about here?
Yeah, so the set of emergency I mentioned initially was just schools. But yeah, this 8,000 projects, they are ranging from schools, hospitals, roads, and then water projects. Okay. They are largely infrastructure projects.
Okay, that's fantastic. I mean, let me pause you there because there might be some questions. I remember just a quick one, going into your governor's office in Kaduna in 2016, a year after he had come into office, and seeing this very impressive dashboard. But I can tell you, there weren't 8,000 projects then. I think there were maybe 200 at that time in 2016. But it's great to see that the program continues and that it's having this kind of impact for ordinary lives of Kaduna residents there. So thank you, Mohammed. We'll come back to you if there are questions. Yeah. Let me move back to South Africa, to Pretoria, and to invite Evelyn Change, who is Chief Governance Officer at the ADB, to maybe give us a more high-level continental view. So the ADB, African Development Bank, recently developed a new governance strategy with public service delivery as an important pillar. So, Evelyn, how does the AFDB see itself supporting public service delivery and social accountability initiatives such as PSAM, especially in the OGP member countries? Are there specifically opportunities for ADB to support public service delivery programs at local government level, or do you stay above at the central government level? Evelyn, welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. And it is a loaded question, but in many ways, I think the strategy for economic governance in Africa, the SEGA, which is going to govern ADB's governance work from 2021 to 2025, is really a consequence of the COVID-19 pandemic. Many of us will recall that immediately coming into the pandemic, the bank put in place a facility of $10 billion to support countries' health response, economic and social response to the crisis. But immediately it was evident that actually the pandemic was a crisis in public service delivery. On the health sector, for example, looking at countries' testing capacity, number of isolation centers that they had, number of hospital beds, access to oxygen, the number of medical personnel. For example, myself, I cover Malawi. When we did the budget support, I think they had 2 isolation centers. The testing capacity, I think, could have been 20 per day results or something like that. So we just did a completion report for that program. And, you know, like the support has been phenomenal in terms of there is access for treatment, I think, in all the districts now. The isolation centers are much more. Of course, there is still work to be done, but it shows just, you know, that the health system coming into the pandemic was relatively weak. And this is not only in the case of Malawi. Then when you think about education, you know, we had to go into lockdown, children delivering online learning. Then you realize what services are there, even without thinking about online learning, even TV learning or any other learning to be able to deliver to, you know, to children. When you talk about, for example, wash services, you know, we are telling people, wash your hands frequently with soap. People are in the markets, people are elsewhere, people are in houses. We've just heard from Philip of a school without running water for 10 days. So what does that mean for tackling the pandemic? We were asking countries to give social protection, you know, in terms of food parcels and things because of lockdown measures. You find a lot of the countries didn't even have statistics of the number of people who might need social services. So it means that this was perhaps not an infrastructure regularly developed that could now be build upon in terms of the pandemic. I also wanted to mention, you know, like issues around the pandemic has had a lot of issues around domestic violence, abuse of children. And you would find that in many countries, you know, there were no hotlines for this. There were no safe houses even before the pandemic. So, you know, you're not going to put them in place, and people have had to suffer in lockdown for almost a year in very bad circumstances. So now I think it is not that, you know, like, and I think that is the question that we are all asking ourselves, both as institutions, as individuals, and as countries. You know, we've been programming for 50 years, probably, supporting public sector effectiveness. So I think this is the reflection that we had to come up with the SEGA, which I think the ADB is trying to get more to the grassroots to impact really on the quality of the ordinary African citizen in terms of public service delivery. So in the SEGA now, you will see, okay, maybe just to say that it has three pillars, one of which is ensuring public sector effectiveness, but traditionally we have focused a lot more at national level, but now it is at national and sub-national level. We have the other pillar is on structural transformation, mostly looking at the private sector, but the reason for structural transformation is to ensure that really we are, you know, working with youth, working with women in business, just trying to make sure that there is really structural transformation. Then the last one is around increasing transparency and accountability and participation. And this is almost a departure from what we used to do before. We did focus on accountability, but I think it is stronger, particularly in terms of civil society awareness, demand side accountability. We have, I would say, a re-energized partnership with different organizations. For example, the OGP, who haven't been necessarily our traditional partner, but we see ourselves working closely together. So some of the things that you will see in the new governance strategy, for example, are things to do with e-governance, transparency in terms of debt, transparency in terms of procurement. We have been looking, you know, like when you think about emergency resources, we are always coming when, you know, the mistake has happened at audit time. So now we are starting at procurement. Who is procuring? How is it being procured? And all of that, more focus on it. We've done it before, but I think this is more. We are having more support for state-owned enterprises because we know the role that they play in terms of service delivery in Africa. As I've mentioned, sub-national governments as well as issues around combating corruption. So this is how we see the ADB intervening in this space. Then I wanted to mention that in addition to our traditional instruments for lending, we do have the result-based financing tool, which I think is a good way of measuring results or puts, I would say it's almost a performance contract for government that you will fund based on delivery of particular targets. And we have done that in different countries. In Morocco, we did that in terms of improving access to employment and social protection in the context of COVID. We have also done that in Rwanda, but I know it's not an OGP country, but it's in scaling energy access. We are considering it in Angola for the water sector, but we see this tool as being quite effective in terms of enhancing public service delivery. We also have, pardon?
It motivates governments to deliver first, and then they're reimbursed for meeting particular targets. Is that what the results-based financing
is? Yes, yes, yes. Because traditionally we had two tools. One is the budget support, which just goes into the budget and, you know, just moves along with the overall development program. Then we had an institutional support project, but that one is more limited in scope. So what the results-based is almost like a blend of that you still put the money in the budget, but the government has to deliver something for you. If it's maybe number of people accessing energy, kilometer of road or something like that, then you monitor it a bit more. Then just the last thing I wanted to mention is that also the bank now has a policy or non-sovereign operations, which allows, for example, lending to, let's say, state-owned enterprises or sub-national or municipalities on their own accord. So if a municipality is doing well and can, you know, it can borrow, I think it helps also in terms of enhancing services. So I think you're going to see different approach from the ADB in terms of service delivery going forward. Thank you.
That's good to know. Thank you for, to see how the bank has responded to the COVID crisis with this new set of, a new approach to service delivery, supporting service delivery. Maybe what I'd one question to ask, how does civil society access bank resources to provide that kind of pressure that Philip was talking about earlier, the kind of pressure that Zukiswa speaks about from civil society side to make sure that the government actually perform? What are there windows for civil society to access bank resources to help enhance public service delivery?
Well, for the moment, there are none, but it is some of the thinking that is coming around. For example, we used to have a governance trust fund, which then we would support different projects. I remember we supported, I think, Transparency International in Kenya. So I think we are currently in the process of trying to put in place perhaps a follow-up governance trust fund. There are other instruments, I would say maybe around empowerment for women and all of that, that are flexible a little bit. But on the whole, I think that is one of the areas that also under the new strategy, we are looking to do more about in terms of working more directly and having these resources.
Okay, maybe we can continue chatting with the OGP. I've got a little bit of experience accessing World Bank funds for civil society organizations and how that might work there. So let me invite participants, if you have any questions, you put them inside the chat and we can ask any one of our four panelists. I haven't seen any yet, though there was a comment from somebody from Germany, actually. But are there any questions or comments from somebody, from participants in the chat? I don't see any here. And we have about 5 minutes again for this discussion here. Philip, I wanted maybe to come back to you. You're still there, Philip. One of the challenges, I think, inside government for including public opinion or citizen participation is that it's a bit messy. It slows things down. It makes those performance contracts harder to achieve. How do you convince your colleagues in government, Philip, that this is a way that perhaps could lead to better and more sustainable outcomes for citizens, including their voices in the planning?
I think, and the truth is, you remember, at the end of the day, the performance contract, it's tied to the manifesto of the ruling party, of the party in power. Mm-hmm. So there's an incentive there, because as much as there's a medium-term plan, as you know that, it's still those elements of public service delivery that also, in a way, creates a favorable opinion with citizens. The incentive structures are different, right? So for the higher level leadership, it's about public opinion, right? And delivering public goods in a way that then you're delivering the manifesto. So that has always been a drive. For other people, and public service is not homogenous, right? So other people, it's about efficiency. And they're good and for them, they get excited when there's efficiency. But also when you have a performance contract, then it also incentivizes resourcing from other sources of funds that are not necessarily the consolidated fund. So it's simply how you play with those three or four. But I think for me, it's really the question is, what is the value of open government and open government partnership? I think for me, that has been the
government people. That's the hard one. What is the value for them?
And that's my point, right? So interesting enough is, you see, open government is incremental. And honestly, this is the genius of this network. Because it's what NAP builds into another. But then what, remember, it carries is almost a collective of people who then have gelled over time to be able to unblock things not necessarily in the public domain. If you look at a lot of countries, a lot of these things surface in the press and in the media. So there's a public theater around inefficiencies. But when you have an open government network, then there's almost a space that is more as government people say, constructive. So the criticism is constructive, right? Yes. So that's incentive.
It's an important word for government.
Yeah.
There is a question here, and I'm going to ask it of Zukiswa from Lara. I think it's Lara Barbosa. What is the first step to making an efficient engagement between government and civil society in order to get those commitments achieved? What is step number one? I was asked this question, by the way, by other OGP leaders about 2 weeks ago. But Zukiswa, help us. What's the first step? And while you're doing that, I'll plug my computer in so that my power doesn't run out. What's the first step, Zukiswa, to making this thing work?
I read that question and I distinctively was wanting to avoid it or avoid answering it. But I mean, I'd be very keen to hear reflections from others. So I'll be quick in my response to it. I think it's a really important question. There's two aspects, I would say, that at least in our experiences have been instructive. The first is taking a small chunk and perhaps the small steps should be in I guess, yeah, the phrase low hanging fruit is quite deceptive, but I think where trust or some aspects or some trust has already been created, or where there are agreements or past relationships that may facilitate that kind of conversation towards mm-hmm. co-creation, I think that's a meaningful small chunk. So one example for us is certainly the collaboration with the National Treasury, whom over years, even where there's been perhaps a slightly adversarial relationship, the trust has been there in the sense that the kind of fundamental kind of shared problem or shared idea of what the problem we're trying to address is has existed for a while. So I think that's one example. I mean, it is just one specific government department or actor in terms of fiscal transparency and open budgets, but it does help to begin a conversation beyond that department and in an institutionalized manner for other departments and other entities and other ministers and other political authorities. The second aspect, which I think is something, I hope in a couple of years, we'll be able to report back to this group and others, is in a context like this particular municipality where we've had some progress in the context of developing and being accepted into the OGP local space, and at least, some form of agreement around what might be feasible and what the shared agenda could be. I think the first step in this instance was in actually just creating a space for dialogue. It is a highly, it's a municipality that's been in the news quite recently for in many respects, all the wrong reasons. Poor service delivery, dismal municipal finance management and a range of other, social and political challenges that are really deep. But ultimately, I think the answer to what has been the first step is really the simplest way of coming around a table. And so a coalition like the Makanda Circle of Unity has been quite central in creating the space in which we say, right, multiple stakeholders with a shared objective of wanting change and wanting things to improve at this local in this local government space, come together and have conversations, difficult conversations, contested spaces, issues in which there are political rivalries in some spaces, but ultimately creating that very simple dialogue space is perhaps an understated or an underestimated first step. It sounds very obvious, but I think the value of it is immeasurable, I would say.
Sometimes, Zukiswa, the most obvious is the hardest thing to achieve. Philip put in a note here, which is very interesting. He says, the first step is recognizing that the business of government and governing is not for government alone. And I think the Kaduna eyes and ears example shows that recognition and how when the government of Kaduna decided, hey, let's hear from the people of Kaduna about the quality of services, it led to those impressive results that came up. Now, there's a few questions, but I'm told by my bosses that we have to go into breakout. And there are three breakout rooms here. So I'm going to hand back over to Maureen to shepherd us into our breakout rooms. Maureen, over to you. But thank you very much to the panelists for your really excellent contributions to help open up this conversation. Thank you all very much. Maureen.
Yeah, thank you, Aidan. And thank you to the speakers as well. Really excellent contributions as always. So in a short while, we'll be moving to the second half of the workshop. I think when you joined, you had this is a 2-hour workshop. So we're joining now breakout groups. What will be required is for everyone to select the group that they're going to go into. So there's a group that's going to stay here, but then there are two groups that are going to join separate breakout groups, and there are links that my colleagues will provide in the chat. So the three groups are education, health, and then water and sanitation. Okay, so those are the three. Now, during the breakouts, we will listen to speakers from other regions as they share their experiences and insights and how they're able to co-create and implement strong public service delivery commitments. The objective really here is to inspire you to spark deeper conversations and also share various ways in which public service delivery has enhanced open government. So the links should be in the chat box now. The water and sanitation group will stay in this main room. So if you had registered and indicated that you'd be in the water and sanitation group, please stay here. If you're joining the others, please use the respective links. There will still be English and French translation, so no trouble with that. And so before we take our 5-minute break where you can get your coffee and do your stretches, please click on the link that takes you to the group in which you choose to be. And then we'll take our 5-minute group, our 5-minute break in the group before we kick off. Okay, sound good? Excellent, thank you guys.
Thank you, thanks everybody. See you in the groups. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. So my name is Adna Karimehich-Oates. I'm the Senior Program Officer for thematic policy areas at the Open Government Partnership. This is the water and sanitation breakout for the Africa Public Service Delivery Peer Exchange. I have put in the chat, if you want to stay in this room, you're in the right place. If you want to join the health or education breakouts, there's separate links for those. So please just look in the chat for those links or let us know if you're having trouble. And my colleague Theo, who is also in this room with us, will help you get there. We also do still have English and French interpretation in this room. So make sure that you have the right interpretation selected at the bottom of your screen. So you heard in the previous session how critical open government approaches are to public service delivery and improving what citizens are receiving from government on public services, but also how government can improve the effectiveness of that delivery through citizen engagement and feedback. And in this session, we're going to be looking at what that looks like in the water, sanitation, and hygiene sector in specifically. We're going to exchange some insights and experiences from co-creation and implementation of reforms in the sector, and then prompt a conversation where it would be great to hear about your experiences and ideas, and also brainstorm on future action. I'd like to though first start the session by acknowledging the importance of water and sanitation as a policy area to be addressed through open government approaches and in OGP action plans. In other words, why is it, you know, why should we be working on this policy area in our OGP action plans? Well, first of all, water and sanitation are recognized as human rights under international law. However, these rights are still not incorporated into many national laws or constitutions, and many countries still need to institutionalize the responsibility to address the lack of access to clean water, sanitation, and hygiene. Beyond this, we're at a moment in time where the intersection of water and sanitation with other global issues is perhaps more obvious than ever. So on COVID-19, the spread of infection and the ability to reduce infection, especially in the days before we had vaccines, and a lot of places still don't have vaccines, has been reliant on access to water and sanitation. As COVID was spreading, there were significant inequalities and injustices in communities, in schools, in health centers, and refugee centers across the world, including inequality of access to water and sanitation services. Alongside COVID, climate change is leading to water stress and insecurity and threatening the sustainability of water and sanitation services. So on all three of these, you know, water and sanitation as a basic human right, as necessary for public health in situations like COVID and for helping address climate change, we have a demonstration of the need for investing in water and sanitation for resilience and for public health. And that's why improving accessibility, transparency, and government accountability over this most precious natural resource is so vital. So what have OGP members done in this sector? So OGP members have enacted already a variety of reforms. Some have included, you know, digital mapping of clean drinking water access points. We're going to hear in this session from Sekondi Takoradi about an initiative to increase collaboration between tenants and landlords in expanding sanitation systems. There are examples of inclusive design of national water plans. Others members have worked on opening up spending on water management, so data on spending on water management. So I just want to show you very quickly some key trends from the region in terms of water and sanitation. If you just let me share my screen very quickly. You can see here, water and sanitation commitments have been fairly popular among Africa and Middle East members historically. About 15% of public service delivery commitments in the region are related to water, sanitation, and hygiene, compared to 6% in other regions. So we have seen good, I think, somewhat good engagement. However, in the last couple of years, as with all other public service delivery commitments, water and sanitation and hygiene commitments in the region have been declining. Effective water commitments in the future could address transparency and opening data, active participation and complaint mechanisms, and spending on vulnerable populations. And we have some excellent resources in the OGP network on, you know, specific actions that can be taken. Specifically, there's a brand new resource, the Declaration on Open Government and Water and Sanitation, that has been put forward by the Water Community of Practice, which are parts of the OGP network. And this is really sort of exactly the kind of thing that our community needs in terms of very concrete actions that can be taken. And I'll put a link to the declaration in the chat very shortly. I would encourage you to take a look and to see as well if you're able to endorse it, because the more information is out there about this declaration, and the more we can engage actors to work on water and sanitation. We also have wonderful resources within the network too, of people who are actually implementing and supporting OGP members on water and sanitation commitments. And we have two of them here with us today. We have Isaac Aidu from Metropolitan Assembly in Sekondita Karadi in Ghana. And we have Panchali Saikia from the Stockholm International Water Institute, who are here to share their experiences and practice on supporting, co-creating, and implementing water commitments. So Isaac, I'm going to start with you. I'm having a little trouble actually with my computer, and I can't see my questions. Theo, would you mind looking up in the document and reading out the question for Isaac starting out?
Yes, just give me a second and I can.
Sorry about that. My computer has decided to mess with me right at this moment.
No, it's okay. Just give me a second so that I go to the right document. Okay. Okay. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
So the question for Isaac is, Sekondita Karadi's commitment to build a partnership with landlord and resident associations to increase the number of household toilet facilities have shown relative success in its implementation. Can you share the benefit and lessons learned of partnering with civil society in co-creating this commitment?
Isaac, you need to unmute. I don't know if you've unmuted yourself.
Yeah, hello.
Hi, Isaac.
Hello. Hope they can hear me.
Hello, Isaac. We can hear you.
Yes. Yes, I hope everybody can hear me. Yes. Good morning, everybody, and I trust everybody is doing well. Thank you for the opportunity. As I've been introduced, my name is Isaac Edu. I am the OGP point of contact for Sekendi Takoradi. And today I want to share with you some of the benefits and then the lessons that we have learned when we did our co-creation. And the commitment area was to build a partnership with landlords through residents association to increase household toilet facility. Benefits and lessons learned of partnering civil society in co-creating this commitment. I will start with a brief background. Why this commitment? Why this commitment? Why this commitment? Why did you develop this commitment? Ghana performs poorly with respect to sanitation. And according to the UNICEF 2015 report, only 15% of the population are using improved unshared toilet facilities, while 23% do not have access to any sanitation facility. With Sekendi Takoradi, it is estimated that only 17% of our residents in the Sekendi Takoradi metropolis have access to improved household toilet facility in their homes, with the remaining 83% relying heavily on the limited public toilet facility available, which are mostly in deplorable conditions. 78% of households residing in informal settlement within the Sekendi Takoradi metropolis have undesirable access to toilet facilities. The situation of inadequate sanitary facility is further compounded within schools at the basic level. Out of a total of 252 basic schools in the metropolis, only 24% have access to toilets, urinal, and hand washing facilities on their compound. So this was the context that we were looking at as an assembly. And when we started the co-creation with the support of civil society, now we are looking at the benefit of partnering with the civil society. So the first one I would like to share is that we partner with the background that I've given, and we needed to find solution to this problem because the household are the main people that do not have this facility. So together working with the civil society, one, partner with the civil society in the co-creation process led to mobilizing and involving broader stakeholders, including vulnerable and marginalized groups. Example, persons with disability, people living with HIV, AIDS, led to the crafting of open government commitment that reflects their hopes and aspirations. So the first benefit is that with our partnership with the civil society, we were able to mobilize all stakeholders, including the vulnerable and the marginalized group, which we could not have done on our own. And based on that, we were able to come out with a commitment that reflects the people's hope and the aspiration from the background that I gave. Two, it also led to the expansion in the level of engagement and consultation from 4 to 10 communities. In our previous action plan, we were able to engage only 4 communities. But with the involvement of coming together and partner with the civil society, we were able to extend the engagement to 10 communities. And in all, we were able to engage close to 1,200 citizens directly. And out of this number, 7 99 were women and youth, 27 persons with disability, and 26 people living with HIV and AIDS. Through this partnership, a civil space has also been created for the marginalized and the vulnerable groups to participate in governance at the subnational level. Four, the CSO's partners were able to mobilize the needed financial resources for the co-creation. So it was the CSOs that were able to mobilize the needed resources for our co-creation. So one of the benefits is that our CSOs were able to mobilize the needed resources for the co-creation, which the government alone would not have been able to, mobilize for us to have an inclusive, participation in the co-creation. And last but not the least is that the partnership has also created a civil space. Now we have a multi-stakeholder forum where we are meeting to explore innovative strategies to tackle WASH challenges, as well as funding opportunities in the implementation of this commitment. Now, every stakeholder has embraced it as a major problem which needs an urgent attention. So these are the benefits of our partnership with the civil society. What are some of the lessons learned? Working together with civil society in co-creation promotes participatory approach that builds trust between government and the public. Two, political leadership commitment is key for successful co-creation and implementation. So with that political and the leadership commitment, it becomes very difficult for us to implement that. And we were able to achieve political and leadership commitment with our partnership with the civil society. They were able to, with their background and their vast experience, they were able to, brought on board all the political and the leadership of the local assembly, traditional authorities, for us to work together. Another lesson I would also like to hammer on is the active involvement of all stakeholders ensure ownership and sustainability of commitment. So this can only be done if you have a strong civil society that you are working with. And last but not the least, another lesson that we have learned is that creation of civil space for the vulnerable and marginalized groups give them a sense of belonging and hope. And this civil space was made possible with our partnership with the civil society. So because of time limit, these are the few that I would like to hammer on. And if there are any further questions, I will respond to. I'll share the presentation. I have a small write-up on that, so I will share with you in the chat box. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Isaac. That was a really clear, I think, presentation of the benefits of engaging with civil society and your lessons learned. And I definitely think your point about the civic space, because very often, public service delivery is not seen as an opportunity to also enhance the opportunities for civic space. And I think you've highlighted that very well by engaging with delivery groups that are focused on service delivery, this is also providing that kind of dialogue and civic space, which is so much needed in the region as well. So thank you for that. I know that there'll be questions, follow-up questions, but I wanna turn now to Panchali Saikia from the Stockholm International Water Institute, which is has been and is continues to be a close partner of OGP. And Siwi has also worked with Isaac in the commitment, supporting the commitment that Isaac was talking about. Panchali, the question for you is, how have open government approaches improved the water sector? Can you give us some examples? And the second part of that question is also on lessons learned. What are the lessons learned for government and civil society on implementing these reforms?
Thank you, Adna, for the platform. Hello, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm very pleased to be also representing the water and open government community of various partners. And we have few among us here today with Water Integrity Network, WRI, and Fundafina from Latin America. So it's kind of, in our engagement in our process with understanding open government in relation to water and sanitation commitments, we have been also involved in supporting countries at different levels in their action plan development in this process. And there has been some, like in the panel discussion today, in the first session, we saw that there has been a lot of challenges that we see in terms of it's not just enough to limit the access to information, but also in terms of how you improve the service delivery mechanisms, like the performances of water utilities. And I would like to share some examples also deriving from what Isaac had presented in terms of involvement of civil society in these processes. And one of these examples comes from Sao Paulo in Brazil, which is talking about innovation in the water management sector. And the Civil Society Alliance for Water had played a huge, immense role in terms of not just bringing the water agenda in the policies, but also in the political agenda, in the municipal focus. So the Alliance for Water is like a diverse group of 60 organizations and movement that focused on environment, consumer rights, human rights, education, activism, and innovation. So it started off more as a kind of an effort to deal with the water crisis, that water scarcity and water crisis that the city was facing, the municipality was facing around in 2014 to 2016. So, and they had kind of identified the lack of transparency in the management of water resources was one of the biggest hurdles that they had seen. And in their effort in terms of looking into how this could be improved, they had done extensive review of the federal constitutions, the legal regulatory framework, and also mapping the responsibilities of cities for water management. And this effort had led to starting off Vote for Water campaign, which then resulted in kind of coming up with a declaration, which was then presented in the parliament as in the form of, in the local government, in the form of a bill in 2016, and then passed in terms of creation of the municipal policy for water security and water management. Here I want to bring notice in terms of, it was not just passing of the bill and then with the campaign that the effort had stopped, but it was also beyond in terms of how this could be implemented. So there were additional efforts that was laid across beyond the creation of the policy itself. And this was more looking into how this institutional mechanisms could be improved in terms of implementation of this policy. And towards this, efforts were made and a directive was signed where a Water Security Commission was formed with about 6 municipal government departments and representation of civil society and also representation of academia, which had then kind of proposed in terms of drafting a proposal to set up a specific body inside the government to articulate and integrate these local actions. And also in terms of building set of indicators that can be used as a powerful instrument for monitoring, improving public policy and wider communication with the society and the citizen. So this is one of the efforts that was laid and is a very good example, not just in terms of design of policies, but also in terms of how efforts were laid in implementation of such policies. Another effort I want to bring to focus in terms of looking into improving the service delivery, making it more citizen-oriented, having more feedback systems. And this is something which is also ongoing. Like, I want to bring to focus as there are a lot of effort beyond the open government commitment efforts that has been made by water sector alone, like the WASH programming in different countries. They are trying to improve the accountability, the participation, transparencies, and also water utilities making an effort to improve the consumers and customers' feedbacks and orientations, improving the tariff settings and making it more citizen-oriented, making it more affordable, keeping in context of the socio-economic, how it is in the informal settlements. So there has been a lot of effort that has been laid by the water sector, but an initiative is needed in terms of improving the collaborations with the open government effort in those countries. And this is where something it's very important that the community of practice we are trying to propagate and kind of promote is reducing the silos that has been in different countries in terms of improving the coordination between the water sector and the open government actors. And here I want to really bring a focus on one of the examples that we had experienced in Laos, where we had trained the water utility in some of the Southeast Asian countries. And I want to bring the example of Laos here. In terms of improving the business models, in terms of improving the water integrity of the utility in these countries to make it more customer oriented, a set of trainings were organized to improve the capacity of these water utilities so they could address various aspects of quality management, service as tools for companies and organizations to improve products and services to meet customer requirement and quality to more continuous improvement of services. And through this capacity development of the water utilities in terms of their business improvement and integrity effort led to the water utility receiving an ISO certification for quality management system. And this ISO certification standard is based on a number of quality management principles, including a strong customer focus. So this kind of efforts are also needed to improve the water utilities and how they're improving the service mechanisms, right? And this addresses some of the questions that were raised in the earlier panel discussions, like, is it just enough to just put data in terms of access to information itself? Or are we also looking into some provision in terms of improving the performances of water utilities, improving the performances of the services in those countries? So this is one of the examples I wanted to share. Coming back again to the OGP process of co-creation of commitments, I want to also bring focus quickly on the dialogue process, which is crucial. And this is one of the lessons that we have learned in terms of having this continuous dialogues across different actors. And this is, I want to bring focus on an example in Lima, in Peru, where the Water Integrity Network, our partner of the community of water, community of practice of water and open government, together with the city water utility and NGOs have kind of engaged at the national level to push this water and sanitation agenda in the open government action plan. And this has been effort towards continuous process. And even during the pandemic, there has been online sessions organized. There has been webinars organized to improve this collaboration, to improve how this potential identifying issues and potentials around open government and WASH related commitments. Another example could be in Makueni County, Kenya, and we have representative here today from the Center for Social Planning and Administrative Development, and I would request and encourage them to share their insights on that. That has also been another process where Water Integrity Network has, together with the collaboration with the civil society organization and the OGP local, had series of stakeholders meeting to develop water commitments. So these are some of the examples where the dialogue process, this continuous involvement of different stakeholders kind of is very crucial. And in terms of the lesson learned, I want to again bring focus when we look into water and open government commitment development, often we also see that there is a lot of conflict when in terms of prioritization across different sectors, right? Limiting the number of commitment in the action plan. And one of the crucial aspects I want to focus is looking into the sustainable development goals. When we look into the sustainable development goal, water and sanitation is the core requisite. It is seen as the docking station for achieving a lot of other sustainable development goals. And here I want to bring an example of, for example, in in relation to schools, in relation to improving education, until and unless we don't address the lack of access to safe and inclusive water services in schools, particularly for girls when gender-sensitive facilities and services are absent. And this is not limited to infrastructure alone, but also kind of advocacy, improving policies, the legal mechanisms in that context will be very crucial. It's also affiliated in terms of how we see this connection between gender equality SDGs, the education, and also the SDGs around water and sanitation. Another could be something if we see the climate mitigation and adaptation, not just in terms of addressing the water-related disasters, coming up with emergency response and recovery measures, but also looking into climate mitigation. Efforts around open defecation, reducing open defecation efforts in different countries have also resulted saying that this has kind of helped the country to achieve their goals around mitigation, reducing the carbon emission. So these are some of the efforts that is needed across sectors and also within the water sectors itself, where efforts could be kind of collaborated when we say that there is a conflict in terms of different competitions between sectors. So what can be done in terms of improving this coordination across different sectors to achieve the SDGs for the countries? So with this, I will end it here, but I'd also encourage the partners and representatives from different countries that we have been engaged with to share their insights as well. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Panchali. That was great. I definitely want to follow up on this question of how to engage water utilities and different stakeholders, because I think this is always, in any co-creation process, that is, it's bringing the right actors around the table that is necessary to have that conversation. So I definitely want to come back to that. I'd also like to ask both you and Isaac about COVID a little bit, but I think we have enough time for that. I know that Valentine from CESPAD in Makueni County is here, and I know that you are currently involved in the co-creation of a water commitment there. So I would like to give you just a couple of minutes to share your experience on this as well.
Thank you, Adna. Hi, how are you guys? Can you hear me?
We can hear you well.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, as you said, I'm Valentine. I am the communications consultant with for CESPAD, and we've been working with Water Integrity Network and CIWI in helping draft a water commitment for Makueni County. Now, just a brief background about Makueni County. Makueni County is an ASL region, and it has a population of about 1 million people. And it's about 8,000 square kilometers. That means that for every square kilometer, there are about 125 people. And it only has three water companies. The rest of the areas, and a lot of the population lives in rural areas, are usually serviced by there are about 347 community water schemes responsible for water supply in the region. In part of what we were doing in terms of our baseline survey, we came to find out that the county government has been grappling issues for governance, community participation, and inappropriate or maybe wrong technology among the community water schemes available. The county in the process has also made quite a few steps in terms of establishing a feedback mechanism, which was an issue that had arisen some time back, or, considering again the distance between some of these villages available. So they came up with a feedback mechanism for reporting of any issues in the project, the community water project, by setting up project level management committees, which are project-specific committees comprised of citizens in charge of the day-to-day supervision of management and of a project during implementation. So this feedback process has been part of the process of improving the water and sanitation, mostly it's the water situation in the county. The county has also been involved in intense communication engagement and public participation models. basically, this is to address and also to inform the public, to educate the public on the importance of public participation in terms of getting the water issues addressed, and also to improve the sanitation sector in Makueni County. The mechanism, the county uses a process budgetary, it's called the participatory budget process. And the mechanism developed by the county ensures that the citizens are involved in all process of development, from the planning and budgeting to project design and preparation to implementation, monitoring, and evaluation. As part of its OGP commitment, Makueni joined OGP, Local Community of Practice, in December 2020. By launching an open contracting and an open data portal just in 2019. So, and part of its commitments to addressing the, to the OGP process included enhancing transparency on company ownership through disclosure of information on beneficial ownership, to implement a phase three of the open contracting data standards that will include project monitoring and evaluation. And also to, as part of its fiscal openness and to, and in order to enhance transparency, the county has also put measures in place to publish final audit and public service performance reports. Going forward, the county government plans to encourage the public to integrate the reports during open forums. Unfortunately, some of the problems that have come out in this entire process is, as I mentioned earlier, the county, most of the citizens in the county live in rural areas. They don't have access to internet. The process of educating the community on how to access this information has been effective, there's still that linkage of how do we get online to get this information if everything is available online. So the county government is working on improving that, maybe getting the information available via SMS. Where we come in as SESPAD in the water commitment and OGP is we realized that while the commitments were very broad and they covered a lot of aspects, there was a need to address water issues because, again, as I mentioned, the county is an ASAL region, and a lot of the issues that affect a lack of water availability in the county includes droughts. The county has had to deal with a lot of climate change issues that have affected accessibility to water. There's also the issue of over obstruction from the water sources that are available. There's a lack of education, a lack of information on the conservation projects that the communities can take up, even as a group, to manage these watersheds that are available. There's also poor agricultural practices and a lack of a county water master plan that addresses these issues. And of course, sand harvesting has also been a major issue in the county. So as part of the commitment process, we met with the government officials. We met with community water projects in representatives. We met with the water service providers in the area, and we met with the CSO network led by a group called MAPAKA. Some of the issues that were identified that are being addressed in the process of developing a commitment process include governance issues, and most of them revolve around a lack of access, commercialization of public water. And there's also a lot of budget and planning issues. This would be mostly be tied to a lack of technical advice and intervention on the guidance of possible water resources in the area that could lead to areas where community water projects can be set up. There's another priority issue that was noticed was capacity building issues, in terms of, yes, while there are these project management committees, a lot of them have they don't have the capacity or the skills involved, you know, in order to monitor and evaluate these projects for sustainability. And the third issue was mostly a pollution of water services in the region. So during the meetings that we've held with the groups I've mentioned before, we've managed to narrow down a lot of these issues, and the county government has committed to forming three clusters to come up with commitment issues around open contracting, ensuring that the two-thirds, the rule of having special contracts available for women, for the youth, and people living with disabilities is followed, because it's in the Constitution of Kenya to ensure that contracts are the contracts which have been set aside to ensure that those three special groups are get contracts in the process. There's also water integrity issues which will address again transparency, accountability, and corruption in the water sector. And there's also the public participation cluster that will address how to better improve public participation in Makueni County. The county government, again, we thank the governor, Professor Kivutha Kibwana. He's been a very big proponent of open government and has been pushing to ensure that there's a water commitment. So through him and the representatives from different departments in the water sector, this would be finance and socioeconomic planning department, devolution, county administration, public service and youth department, the water and sanitation department, finance and socioeconomic planning department, devolution, county administration, public service and youth department have all come together, and they've assigned a letter approving the commitment of the formation of these three clusters that will address and come up with these commitments by the end of July of this month, of this year, sorry. And this will be a two-year action plan, which will also involve a lot of monitoring and evaluation. Each cluster has members who are representative from all the departments I've mentioned above, including a lot of monitoring and evaluation to ensure that these commitments are entrenched within the greater county commitments that the county has come up with to ensure that the county addresses its water issues in the next 2 years. I will be taking any questions later for anyone who has any questions, but for now, back to you.
Thanks, Valentine. You actually ended on a really good spot talking about how in each of the clusters you have the different actors involved and engaged. And I think for implementation, for successful implementation, this is what we have seen in the history of OGP across commitments, that first of all, getting the buy-in of all the different actors that are involved and getting them in the design process early on and ensuring their engagement and their awareness and acknowledgement of their responsibility really helps with that implementation. And I know you will recall from the very beginning of the 2-hour session today that we noted that, you know, it's not the problem necessarily of having commitments, it's the implementation that's the problem. So I really, really want to focus on that point and highlight how important it is, not just in water, it's across all commitments. It's having that space and having everybody bought in from the very beginning. Isaac and Panchali, that actually comes back to the question that I wanted to ask you. In what you have seen, Isaac, in Sekondi, and Panchali across the projects that you have been engaged with, whether it's been through OGP or outside of OGP, how have you communicated with water service providers and others? Civil society is on one side, but it's also getting that buy-in from water service providers and government that's really key. So maybe Isaac first, what is it, how have you ensured their engagement? What was the selling point? How did you sell them to be engaged and participate in this process. I'll give you 1 minute each maybe to respond to that question.
Okay, thank you. For us here in Secondita, what we have been doing or what we did is to request for a nomination to be part of the multi-stakeholder forum. So we have a representative from the Ghana Water Company, who is a member of our multi-stakeholder forum. Then when you come to the local government itself, there's a committee which is responsible for planning, coordination, and monitoring. We also have a representative from the Ghana Water on that committee. Then the Spatial Planning Committee also have a rep from the Ghana Water Company. So these are the areas that we use to engage them. So when it comes to the OGP, at the multi-stakeholder forum, we have a representative there. So any issue we're able to, you know, talk about. One thing exciting is that on our platform, if members or anybody come across issue, if there's a water bed somewhere, they will quickly put it on our platform, Ghana Water. This is what is happening here. Quickly, he will also pick it up and ensure that it is resolved and he come back to report. So these are the platform that we use to engage them. So we have them on our various committees so that engagement is very simple. So that we don't go through the long bureaucratic way of doing things in the public service. Once we have them on your committees or your platforms, it becomes very easy to even at times have informal engagement with them. Then the issues are resolved.
But Isaac, one follow-up to that. How do you, what is the benefit to them? What do you tell them of being part of the platform?
Yes, being part of the platform has given the citizens direct, you know, that their representatives has direct contact with them. So like I said, things that you have to go through the normal process. Now you can, and you don't go through the formal, but you can use the informal way to what? Engage them directly, not to wait those kind of going through the bureaucratic way of things done at the local government service or the public service. It has helped to reduce that bureaucratic way of doing things in the public service. Getting direct contact with their representative.
Thank you, Isaac. Panchali, from your perspective, you know, basically getting the engagement, not just of civil society, right, but of water service providers and other stakeholders. What has your experience been in sort of the successful way of getting that engagement?
Yes, just to share some examples of our engagement with different countries on improving their WASH programs through good governance, through the integration of this open government principles of accountability, transparency. We have seen that a strong local level ownership at that level is important. And this is where something we do is more of engaging with the ministries or with the department, with the water utility from the very start in the process. And some of these efforts around implementation through use of different tools, guidelines have been very useful for us, like the accountability mapping triangle, which helps in terms of mapping and identifying different stakeholders in the context of WASH sector in a country, looking into the policy level, the service provider level, and the community user level. And this could differ in terms of when you looked into more fragile context where external support agencies plays a very crucial role, the donor agency plays a very crucial role, who serve in those fragile contexts as the service provider. So in this kind of things, implementation of these tools have been very useful. So use of the tools in terms of making them realize that yes, there has been some existing gaps that you can identify and improve the sector. And this is where some of the tools around, say, the WASH bottleneck analysis tool with UNICEF, also the integrity toolbox, management toolbox with water integrity and network that we have implemented. These are tools that really helps the stakeholders to really get a picture, the scenario of the current scenarios, how their sector is performing. So this really helps in terms of advocating. But beyond this, we also, I will give an example of in Bolivia, where we did was after this kind of scenario analysis is done, it's very important to establish an accountability mechanism, right? So that these kind of action plans and those that the gaps they have identified, the solution they have identified is carried forwarded. It's very similar to how this commitment around OGP action plan is done. And this is where it comes on the implementation. The commitment from the local level is very crucial. And in Bolivia, what we did is with the municipality, there was a declaration signed and a platform, a multi-stakeholder platform was initiated, which had helped in terms of their continuous engagement with the sectors that they had not earlier engaged before. There is another example from Suriname where we included from the very initial stage of discussion, the indigenous representatives in the discussions with the water utilities, with the departments of ministry, and with the involvement of the indigenous representative at the very start, kind of came at the later stage when we were trying of developing this multi-stakeholder platform, the Ministry of Interior came in on board. So it's kind of how you really engage different stakeholders. It's very important, like we were discussing, like before we reach the implementation stage, it's also important that a lot of the stakeholders are involved, and water utilities sometimes need to have these conversations with different organizations. So they also share that they lack those informations. Sometimes it's not just about the data being available in the country, whether it's kind of collected or not, whether this data is disseminated to the right stakeholder at the right time or not. So they share that sometimes they don't know what is the need and demand of different stakeholders, need and demand of different users from different geographical locations, because sometimes some of the areas are kind of the service providers are informal service providers, the formal service sectors doesn't know how many of these informal service providers are present. So, and sometimes there are communities who themselves serve as a service provider. So lack of knowledge of utilities sometimes really kind of is a hurdle for them in terms of designing proper programs. So these are some of the examples I wanted to share, but I would also leave Daniela if she wants to share her experience engaging with different countries on the co-creation process on water and open government. Thank you.
Thanks, Panchali. Daniela, do you want to come in? Daniela is from the Water Integrity Network. Daniela, you're on mute if you want to come in.
Thank you, Adnan. Thank you all. Thank you, Panchali. Thank you, Valentine, and thank you, Isaac, for your interventions. Just to close a little the session, I would like to say from the Water Integrity Network and from the experiences we've had accompanying different civil society organizations, both in the co-creation of the commitments, but as you said, also Adna, in the implementation. I think it's key, and one of the key challenges or key lessons learned that we have identified, it's this lack of information on one side from key transparency and accountability institutions from the water sector. So that's why it's so important to create this bridge or to level the field within anti-corruption and transparency agencies on the importance also of promoting these issues on the water sector and how these issues specifically materialize in the water sector. I think that also the work that Valentin was explaining to say how these specific issues of transparency and corruption, participation and accountability work or are shaped within the water sector in Makueni County kind of explain a little bit how they change or how these issues materialize in different sectors. So that would be the first opinion. And the second one would be associated more also bringing these principles into the water sector as well. I think that there's also a lack of information between water sector organizations, also the importance of promoting these principles and these OGP principles. So that's why it's so important to have spaces like this in which we can share also different experiences from the region, but in which we can also identify how to start promoting these topics. So thank you very much. And we are open also to answer any questions or to continue kind of having bilateral conversations with different stakeholders in case some of you are interested in continue kind of in this process of co-creation and also in implementation from the community. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Daniela. And I think that's also a very good place to start wrapping up the session because we are getting, I think we're 1 minute past our allotted time. Daniela mentioned, you know, being open to continuing the conversation. If you would like to actually continue this conversation about how to work on water and sanitation through OGP, there is on the water and sanitation policy page of the Open Government Partnership website, there is a link to the community of practice, which is this group of partners that are here to support OGP members on co-creating and implementing water and sanitation commitments. So the support unit together with the community practice really is there. I think, you know, you have made some excellent points, all of you, about the value of civil society collaboration, what it means for that direct contact with citizens, also for the lack of information, you know, cross-sectoral information about, you know, how to address corruption in the water sector, how to address some of those issues, lack of information of water service providers about how to engage in the OGP process. So I think continuing that bridging of conversations is really important. I just want to wrap up with some of the, I think, key points that we see that we want to have as takeaways from the session. So, you know, we have seen, as was highlighted in the previous session, that open data and anti-corruption commitments are very popular in OGP, but and public service delivery issues tend to be a smaller component. But if we really want to see more impact and seeing these principles, as Daniela was saying, in the water sector, we need to make them more concretely about addressing and enacting open government in the public service delivery sector and in the water sector in this case specifically. We have seen that even though public service delivery has been a consistently popular area of focus, there needs to be better implementation. We've talked a lot about what that means. It means having that buy-in across stakeholders from the get-go and having them part of the design process. Using open government approaches, finally, the takeaway allows governments to draw on the eyes and ears of citizens and civil society to deliver and implement better services and reduce inefficiencies in resources. This is really a call to create more of those collaborations and partnerships in the water and sanitation sector. I want to thank Panchali and Isaac and Valentine for really sharing some specific experiences and lessons learned from your contexts with all of us. And thanks to everybody else for joining today for this whole 2-hour session. I hope it was useful for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.
Thank you.